from the New York Philharmonic's new star conductor to Manila's Russell with an 8.7% inflation reading to President Marcos' trip to Japan. And if we have time, the Adani saga. We've got a lot of headlines to unpack in this month's Stephenomics. Without further ado, joining us this morning, global investment banker Stephen Kunyang. Stevie, hi.
Hi, thanks again for inviting me. And if I look disheveled, it's because I feel disheveled. I just got back last night after 10 p.m. and then was crazy enough with my friend Nori Poblador to play tennis at 6:30 this morning.
Oh,
so if I look, it's because I got home late and started playing tennis at 6:30.
All right, so that's what investment bankers, the successful people, do. Anyway,
retired investment bankers.
All right, Stevie, I want to start with a picture. This picture, I think we can flash this picture, which is related to a breaking story, really. This is you with New York City Mayor Adams at the New York Philharmonic Lunar New Year Gala. And yes, Here's why it's breaking news, because the New York Philharmonic has just announced that it has lured famed Venezuelan conductor from LA, Gustavo Dudamel, I hope I said it right, marking a major shakeup in the world of classical music. Why is this important, Stevie?
Well, it's not. It's just a lot of fun, but Dudamel is considered the heir to Leonard Bernstein, and the golden era for the New York Philharmonic, of which they've had many, was probably Bernstein's head. And his daughter, Jamie, in her own book, said she sees Dudamel as the spiritual heir of her father, Leonard Bernstein. So, and Leonard Bernstein was 40 when he headed the New York Philharmonic, and Dudamel is 42. So maybe they feel it could be a harbinger of glory days to come, which the New York Philharmonic hasn't had to that level since Bernstein stepped down over 50 years ago.
All right. So, well, you did attend this gala. It's a Lunar New Year gala. What were some of the important conversations you've had from that evening? I think we have more pictures of you with some important people.
Well, I'll be very honest. There was no important conversation. It was just lots of fun. All right?
Okay.
I have no excuse. So this is the soloist, the heir who soloist, Yimin Lee, in the middle. And then to the right is one of the violinists of the New York Philharmonic. Sunna.
Well, you and remember.
The other, that's the violin soloist, Ning Feng.
Next photo.
I think we have the conductor Long Yu, who's
the most powerful
conductor in China, because he heads the three most important orchestras there: the China Philharmonic in Beijing, the Shanghai Symphony, and the Guangzhou Symphony. So it was a great honor to meet him, and he's a regular guest conductor of the New York Philharmonic, and that's my fellow international board director Derek Hu. And the joke, the most hysterical thing, is that I am the least fashionable member of my family. I'm very proud to say I'm the only one who's never appeared in the society page. And that last picture was from Vogue.
From Vogue, I know. I saw the feature.
How that happened, my late mother must be howling from beyond that her most unfashionable child is the one who came out
Who made it on Vogue. But Stevie, so this is for the Lunar New Year, which is the year of the rabbit. We all know it's the year of the water rabbit. And aside from the rabbit, there's another thing that's been hopping to higher highs, and that's inflation, at least in the Philippines, blowing past estimates, 8.7% in January. How should investors view inflation? Should it change the way we invest? I mean, I know it's not bad. It's not all bad, because you don't want a deflation problem like Japan either, right?
Well, I mean, be honest, it is worrying, because we are a retail and mall-driven economy. And if the problem, okay, not the problem, it's reflective. If you look at the commodity group index for the consumer price inflation in the Philippines, if you put 100% as the total, 38.98% is food and non-alcoholic beverages, and housing is 22.4%, and transport is 7.8%. So clearly, if you have a lot of inflation in food and in transportation, it's going to be high, because that's what happens when the economy is skewed the way it is. And you and I have been talking till we're blue in the face about agriculture. I don't, I mean, obviously, I'm on one side of the discussion, some other people on the other side, but let's get results. Mm-hmm. I mean, you look, I'm not going to rehash today the import and price versus food security and local production argument, but let me just say, if even in other countries, they are now seeing challenges from this. Like, there was a New York Times article that, forget about pets, what people in suburbs are buying are hens because of inflation on eggs. If you look at their, a lot of complaints and in Egypt because of lack of supply of eggs. I mean, are we really going to try to import our way to food security when other countries who've gone down this path are now having a very hard time? Or is the need for, the problem for me, I think, with a lot of our mindset, especially the sort of leave it to the private sector types, is a lot of the fundamental changes needed are hard. They require a change in behavior and effectivity of government, a change of behavior and effectivity in the private sector, and with consumers. But my argument is it's needed. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not saying it's easy. I'm not saying existing governments dating back to before I was born have been effective in doing it. No, they're not. But it doesn't mean, therefore, don't do it.
So what must be done, Stevie? I mean, you've got the president. He's the agri chief.
Okay. Now, my personal view is, you want to leave existing farms small, that's fine. Then have a proper co-op system. It works in Vietnam. It works in Thailand, where they have small farmers, but they're forced to have co-ops, which have four times our productivity. I was talking, I won't mention his name because it's a private conversation, the CFO of a global food company. He said it's the same thing in Greece. It's all co-ops, but they're all farmers with small lots of land, similar to the ones here, but their productivity is fantastic. There's effective contract growing, there's good prices, or at least reasonable prices, because they pool economies of scale. If you're in the US, one of the biggest brands of butter is Land O'Lakes. That is a co-op, that's not a company. I mean, there are solutions. They're not easy. They've not been done successfully in the Philippines previously, but it doesn't mean it shouldn't be done. And food security domestically is not possible. Mm-hmm. Now, it's hard, but it doesn't mean it's wrong.
Mm-hmm. All right. This food security issue, do you think, I mean, the president is in Japan right now for a 5-day working visit. Do you think there's something that we can take away from this foreign trip in response to this food security issue? I mean, what are there lessons that we can learn from Japan?
You know my view. Yes, Japan is a country. Okay, what is the Japanese model? They subsidize farmers for food security. Food prices are a little expensive, but they have satisfied farmers, and they have no food shortages. In spite of their population density, they're one of the few countries in Asia who still have a population higher than us. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you want to do that? Fine. But they also have high productivity. I mean, at the end, the key is productivity. Mm-hmm. And there are many ways to achieve it. I'm not saying I'm an agricultural expert who knows the way, but when our productivity is 1/4 of our neighbors,
it is.
We're at 1/4. Yes. Oh. All right. Because it's not because their soil is better or their farmers.
But they have the Mekong River, which makes irrigation much easier.
The Mekong River is just a river that doesn't go up and down. Okay. The country is wider than the two boundaries of a river. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, maybe the Mekong River helps. Does that basically add 300% productivity a river? Of course not. All right. So now, even if it helps for transportation within, it doesn't help for production. Now, for production, they have proper irrigation, they have co-ops, they have mechanization, even though they've kept the farms individually owned and small. Hmm. Thailand for sugar and for rice. Imagine if they were like us, we'd all be starving because there wouldn't be rice to feed the rest of Asia.
Stevie, aside from agriculture, is there anything else we can take away from this Japan trip? I mean,
I don't know. Let's see when they come back. But you know my view on foreign trips. It's good
what
for
is your,
pageantry.
yeah, I was
It's
going to
good for
ask.
pageantry and all that. But there is, in my view, there is nothing that will be signed that wouldn't have been signed anyway. And there's nothing that will, I mean, some new initiatives may happen, but it's on the margin. Okay. Now, it's good to improve your profile, everything.
The
But
pageantry. Is the
I mean,
pageantry important?
yes, because it has, it's important to a point. Okay. I have a more skeptical view of that of others, but you know, I'm not president. I'm not in government. I'm not here to, you know, nitpick over small things.
All right. So let's start. Let's shift gears now from Agri to the president's trip to Japan to the Adani sell-off. You must be monitoring this story like crazy. It's been in the
Adani,
headlines.
that's hysterical because for me, it just proves two things. Valuations matter. Before everybody talks, do you know what Adani Enterprises was trading at? And what does it do? It's coal mining, incubation, roads, data centers, and renewable energy. So kind of like a conglomerate. You guess what was the valuation?
What?
136 times forward PE.
Wow.
Exactly. So it's valuation driven. I mean, was it overdue for a correction? Yes. Are the underlying businesses sound? Yes, but they're not worth 136 times PE.
All right.
Now, what is a related issue to that? The increasing limitations of passive investing. In the US, about 15 years ago, about 40% of the mutual funds were ETFs, exchange traded funds, in other words, index driven passive. Whatever the S&P, if it's an S&P 500 fund, whatever's the S&P 500, up or down, that's it. If it's basically MSCI Global Index, whatever's MSCI, it. That's why now it's about 60 to 65%. So in other words, more than half of the mutual funds in the US are passive. In other words, they make no investment decisions. They just mirror the index. So you don't analyze, is Adani overpriced or underpriced? It's in the index. If it has a 2% weighting, then I have a 2% weighting. That's now, normally in the diversity of holdings, that is good. But it does mean people are not going to scrutinize as carefully. Now, you can say one bad stock out of 500 good stocks, it's still better than paying too much for an asset manager who may or may not have missed this anyway. But the Adani run-up was partly because passive investing on the upside and downside feeds on itself. If your market cap goes up, your weighting goes up. Then the people in the passive funds have to increase their holdings. If the stock goes down, they have to decrease their holdings regarding to the weighting, regardless of whether my what my short, long, or fundamental view is. And if in the US now, over 60% is that way.
Do we face similar risks here in the Philippines?
Well, I mean, to the extent that we have in Asia, the ratio of active towards passive investing is still more balanced. But the trend for the last 20, 30 years has been increasing passive investing because it's cheaper and it's diversified. Because why pay for a fund manager when the sheer diversification from the indices makes you basically you get whatever the market performance of the index you choose is. There are now so many sub-funds that you can almost choose any index you want. Chinese technology, you want India only, you want Asia, ex-Japan and China. Any index you want, you can find. Okay? You want financial services only. There are all these indices and you can do it passive. But that will basically feed into this and that. So the story is first, it's apparently a very decent and respected company. The valuation was
Minus the accusations of the short seller, Hindenburg.
yeah, but I don't want to comment on the accusations because they are responded. I mean, people can say I'm very handsome, people can say I'm very ugly. It's an opinion until it's proven factually. It's a view. Now, I have not seen proof of the allegations or proof of its denial. So until then, I'm not part of the chismis train that makes decisions based on conjecture. But without even any comments, if you're trading at 136 times forward earnings and you're not growing over 100% a year, you're overvalued.
All right, and it always catches up, right?
Yes,
Eventually.
I mean, it catches up if the fundamental says. Now, supposing you are growing 100% a year, like for a couple of years, the tech stocks grew faster. Then, at least for a while, they were justified. So it's partly the share price is a dynamic. There's a very important ratio, PEG, which is PE to growth ratio.
All right. We're used to PE, so
Generally,
it has to be PE to growth.
yeah, so like for example, somebody says my PE is 10, the other says my PE is 20. Is the 10 PE better than the 20? No. If the 10 times stock is growing 5% and the 20 PE is growing 50%, the 20 is cheap and the 10 is expensive. So
Very.
you have to put that in PEG.
All right. And on that note, PEG, never enough time, Stevie. Thank you so much for this month's Stevenomics. More exciting discussions for next month. See you soon.
See you then. Thank you very much.
Thank you.